If you were with us last week, I began what is turning out to be a three-part series concerning the subject of spiritual warfare. And last week we talked about spiritual warfare, knowing your enemy, and shared a little bit about the enemy that we face, who is, according to the scripture, a very personal enemy, a person, a created being, Satan. We talked about these three things about him primarily, that he is a created being. He's not infinite. He's not eternal. He is a created angel that has fallen and has set himself against God and against the people of God. We also said that he is a defeated enemy. And we read from the red letter gospel of Jesus, who told us that he had defeated him at the cross. And I kind of ended in the middle of the message, and my last point was that he is limited in the things that he can do, and I want to start there today just briefly and give you three things that Satan cannot do, and he is limited. Number one, Satan is not omniscient. He doesn't know everything. Now, having said that, he's a very good mind reader, and he's an astute student of human nature, probably because he is the author of a great deal of the nature that humans act under. But does he know everything? Is he God? He does not. Had he known everything, he would never have let Jesus go to the cross. He played into the master's hands. Neither is Satan omnipotent. He is not all-powerful. He is just a created being, stronger perhaps than us. We would not want to stand toe-to-toe with him and do battle, but not stronger than the one who lives within us. Greater within is the one who's in you than he that's in the world. If I could think of an analogy to explain that, I would say Satan is like a pit bull on a chain. But at the end of that chain is God. And he's only going to go as far as God lets him go. And he's only going to do what God allows him to do. And then the third point is that Satan is not omnipresent. He can't be everywhere at once. He's not like God. I was listening to a teaching of this with Alistair Begg, and he made this point. He said, probably none of us have ever dealt with Satan one-on-one. Now, he doesn't need to deal with us one-on-one because he has armies of demons, and he has a world that is following him because the Bible describes him as the god of this world. So the odds are you and I have never actually seen or dealt with Satan one-on-one. He has limitations. That was our spiritual warfare, knowing our enemy. This week I want to talk about our spiritual warfare, being equipped for the battle. We're reading out of Ephesians. But before we start there, in Corinthians, Paul wrote this to the church. He said, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. We take every captive and every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ." That's 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. Paul here is describing the battles that we go through. And in Ephesians, he tells us, and we read last week, we're not at war with flesh and blood. We're not at war with people. You're not my enemy, I'm not yours. Your husband's not your enemy, your wife's not your enemy, your children are not your enemy, your parents are not your enemies. We war against the ideas, the attitudes, the philosophies that rule the world and that govern selfish men who are living in their base nature. And today we're going to look at a few verses on how God equips us to face the battle and how God equips us to defend ourselves. There are two aspects to the armor of God, as is listed here in Ephesians. There is defensive armor that he gives us, and there is offensive armor that he gives us. Today we're going to talk about our defense against the wiles of the devil. And next week we'll finish up talking about how we go on the offense and how we bring the battle to him. Martin Lloyd-Jones, considered by many one of the greatest preachers of the 20th century, wrote a book about the four or five scriptures that I'm going to read to you today. And it's 375 pages long. And then he went back and he wrote another book that was 365 pages long, roughly 740 odd pages on these very few verses that we're going to talk about. So we're not going to exhaust the subject today by talking about it for a few minutes. It's a vast subject, but it is very, very, very important that we as Christians understand that we have been recruited into an army. We weren't drafted, we joined. But we have to understand that that means we're at war, we're at battle. And in this war, you will either be a warrior or you will be collateral damage. And we do not want that to happen. So we look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. I'm going to break these verses down. We're going to do it kind of in an expository way, more of a teaching. It's going to be like a big Sunday school class, only you don't get to talk back to me, okay? I'll talk, you listen. Therefore, what's the therefore, therefore? The therefore, of course, follows what he had said to us earlier, that we need to be strong in the Lord. We need to put on the full armor of God, for we have an enemy who is scheming against us. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers and the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of the evil in the heavenly realms. As a result of that, you're fighting a war here. You're fighting a war that's from the enemy that's coming from above. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. The first instruction that we're given by the Apostle Paul, and this is very important, we have to begin at the beginning. He says, put on the full armor of God. The word for full is panoplia in the Greek. It means this, all, leaving nothing out, no exclusions. It will not be enough if you're going to succeed in your warfare against the spiritual darkness in this world for you to say, all I need is this part. All I need is a shield of faith. That won't be enough. So Paul's saying emphatically here that we need to put on the full armor of God so that we can stand as warriors in this battle. Paul is speaking to the church, but he's speaking to the church in an individual sense. You. So that we all have the armor of God on. And I'll refer to that a little bit later. And then the next thing that I notice is the command that he's given. He gave it the verse before, he gives it here, and he gives it the verse after. And it's the command is to stand. We are in enemy territory. If Satan is the god of this world, we are standing, we are living in enemy territory. Ruled by the god of this world. This is not the promised land. This is the wilderness. This is not the destination. This is the journey. You know what I'm talking about? When God delivered the children out of Israel, or out of Egypt, they had to pass through the wilderness, and many of them did not make it. They died there in the wilderness. This is not our final destination. We're passing through, and as we do, we are taking territory from the enemy that seeks to destroy us with his wiles and his schemes. In Ephesians, Paul is giving us a metaphor. We're going to look at that metaphor today, and we're going to examine these items that we're equipped with. Now, for the Ephesian citizen, it would have been something that they would see every day. No doubt that in Ephesus, which was a major city, there was at least a Roman garrison there. And so every day in the streets, they would see soldiers. They were occupied. And they would see these soldiers as they marched through the streets, and they would hear them as they marched on the cobblestone, and I'll explain why they'd hear them later. And so Paul takes this example of something that's common, the warrior that's common. Now, in his day, the Roman army was the most efficient, most modernized army on earth. It was building an empire, and it was a sophisticated army. Unlike many of the other pagans around who recruited people, you know, just anybody to come into their army, the Romans did not. The Romans required certain things of their soldiers. One of them is they had to be able to read. They had to be educated because they thought this, that if they can read and they have that level of understanding, then they can understand war tactics. And when we tell them to respond a certain way, they'll know to respond a certain way. They'll know the language. They'll know the vernacular of a soldier. And that's good advice for us today. If you're going to be in the army of the Lord, it's a good thing that you know the training manual. And you know the instructions that God would give to us. So they weren't just the average pagan soldier. And so Paul begins to describe the armor that they wear. And in doing so, I believe not so much Paul, but the Holy Spirit is giving us these examples, and there's pertinent, and there's certain things about each garment that is unique and the things that it describes. And so the first thing he says is that we must put on the belt. He says, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. The first thing, if you're going to fight a spiritual battle, that you need to know is truth. Truth is that which defines reality. It's best that you know what's real and what you're facing. And so the picture that we get is Paul is the Roman soldier girding himself up. The King James Version says, gird your loins. Do we have our picture up there? This is what the Roman belt would look like. It was called the cingulum. And it ensured several things. Number one, it ensured that the sword was held secure to the body. You see, if you're going into battle, it's not a good idea to lose your sword on the way. It's a good idea to have it strapped to your side before you want to draw it out. And the belt that was given to the Roman soldiers held their sword, and if they were prosperous enough, they may have a dagger in it. And there was a hook for their spear, and there was also a hook, some of them, for their shield, so that when they traveled, everything put its weight on the belt. And so it was important that it be girded up tight. When I was a firefighter, I worked with Brad Stevenson. I don't know if any of you know him. And then back in the 1990s, Brad went to Las Vegas, and he won the competition as the world's strongest firefighter. I think he lifted at about 35 pounds. That's about what I weigh right now. I'm not sure I could lift nearly 2,000 pounds in three lifts, and that's about what he did. Phenomenal numbers. But every time I saw him lift, you know the first thing he did? He put that belt on. And he strapped it up because he knew this: if that core doesn't stay tight, something's gonna blow out, and you're not gonna like it when it happens. So he would take that belt and crank it so tight he could barely breathe. But he knew that then he could put all of his power into the lift, and he could move it because that wasn't gonna fade or break upon him. Essential. And Paul's saying here, the belt girds the waist. And it holds us tight. It takes the core of everything, and it keeps it in its place. And that belt is truth. If you don't begin there, forget about it. If the gospel isn't true, it isn't any good. It's worthless. If these things, these other things, aren't based in reality, you're putting on things that are basically a sham. The belt of truth. And I think he meant that in both an objective and a subjective sense. Let me explain that to you. Several weeks ago, Brian talked to us about truth. And he talked about objective truth, which is basically absolute truth. There are things that have to absolutely be true in order for us to function in life. Gravity absolutely has to hold you to the earth. And in spiritual things, the idea that God, there is a God, he rewards those who diligently seek him. He has a son named Jesus who came to die for your sins. That's the only way to salvation, is an absolute, objective truth that we strap around ourselves and we begin every process in our lives with. But truth is also found in a subjective sense. And by that, I mean more pragmatic. It also means that I have to be, and you have to be, people who tell the truth. We have to be people of the truth who live it and walk it. Because if we put a garment on, whether it's the belt or the breastplate or anything else, I put this jacket on this morning. I'm not only wearing it, I'm modeling it. Am I not? You're looking at me and how chic I look in my favorite jacket, or how chic I would have looked 10 years ago in my favorite jacket. Subjectivity toward truth and later toward righteousness means that I wear it and I model it. Paul says, be truthful in your speech and in the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness in your right hand and in your left. we believed in Christ and we were included in him, according to the first chapter of Ephesians, when we heard the salvation, the message of truth. So that's where we begin. Without truth, as the undergarment, without truth is that which sustains and holds everything up, then we will not be able to function as a warrior or as a soldier of Christ. So we strap on the belt of truth. That's the first thing that Paul says. Then he goes on in that verse, and he says, and with the breastplate of righteousness in place. The Roman soldier wore a breastplate. And Steve, if you bring that up, it looks like this. This is the breastplate of a common Roman soldier. Almost every sermon I've ever heard concerning these things, the preacher has inevitably said that God does not make armor for your back. You ever heard that? He makes armor for your front so you can go into the battle. He doesn't make armor for back. That assumes that the enemy's not going to sneak up on you. That assumes that the devil's not going to attack you from behind, doesn't it? That's not true. Sure he does. So it isn't true that God only armors your back. Show us the next picture. This is the back of a Roman soldier. Is that armored? Surely is. You see, righteousness doesn't cover us on one side. It covers us on all sides. It surrounds us, knowing that the devil may well strike at your back, may sneak up on you when you least expect him to show up. The armor of God is provisional. The truth of belt, the belt of truth of belt, whatever, encircles us. It girds us. And so does this breastplate. I always thought, well, there's the breastplate. But it's also a backplate. It's designated for one purpose, to protect your heart. It exists to protect the soldier's heart, because out of our heart grow our desires. Out of our heart comes our will. Out of our heart comes that which really pushes us through life. So God protects our back as well as our front. God chose the lowly things of this world. And by the way, I'm going to read some scriptures today, but I'm not going to give you the references. I'm not going to take it. They're all listed at the bottom there of the bulletin. God chose the lowly things of the world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. There again, the breastplate is something that you are inside. And there again, righteousness needs to be looked at on two levels, the objective level and the subjective level. The objective level is this: by virtue of our union with Christ, we have been given standing with God, and like truth, is both objective and subjective. It is the breastplate of righteousness that covers my heart and declares me justified before God. Righteousness means I have right standing with God. And the basic message of our gospel is that you are made righteous from receiving the righteousness of Christ. He who knew no sin became sin for you, that you might become the righteousness of God in him. To be clothed in Christ is to be as righteous as you're ever going to be. And that is the truth. That is the objective truth. That is the universal truth. That is the absolute truth. But the enemy wants to condemn us. And when he comes to condemn us, he doesn't have a leg to stand on, because our testimony is Christ Jesus is my righteousness. And I am in him. Now, the subjective part of that is just like truth. Righteous living is to be part of all my days and all my decisions as well. Jesus did not give me righteousness so that I could lay it over here and go off to battle. Jesus gave me his righteousness so that I can wear it and walk in it and model it. John says this to the church: dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. In other words, this righteousness, I did not produce it, I did not pay for it, I did not issue it. It was issued to me as a breastplate. It was gifted to me and to you. That's objective. But I have to wear it and I have to use it. That's subjective, because that's why it was made. Why was it made? It was made so that you and I could go into battle against the enemy and survive, and our hearts be protected. Our wills, our desires, our wants made pure. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. We are not saved by any good works that we do, but we are saved to do good works. Our good works is not our redemption. It's the evidence of our redemption. See what I'm saying? It's of no good for God to give me a breastplate of righteousness if in battle I'm not wearing it or I don't intend to use it. But he has given us this, and it will protect my heart. It's imputed to us, and it will protect our hearts from the evil one, but only if indeed we're wearing it through our actions. The person who has a false declaration of faith and declares himself righteous in Christ and yet continues to live a sinful life is vulnerable to every satanic attack and is susceptible to every kind of temptation. I'm going to read that again. The person who has a false declaration of faith and declares himself righteous in Christ and yet continues to live a sinful life is vulnerable to satanic attack and susceptible to every kind of temptation. It is an understanding that when we've been given the breastplate of righteousness to protect us, and that God has done it by the fact that he loves us and he cares for us, that I am enabled to live a life that's pleasing to him. So when we come up to, when we meet a person who is professing Christ, yet living in sin, we know one of two things is true. Number one, they're deceiving their own heart, and the profession isn't real. James says this, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Is it possible for Satan to deceive you, me? Yes. Is it possible for me to deceive me? Yes. That's why truth is the belt. What the word of God says endures forever. So that person is either deceiving himself or he is in a backslidden condition and he needs revival. You know, churches don't have revival much anymore, do they? Along the process of losing it, I think the church began to look at revival as an evangelistic service where we're reaching out to the those that aren't saved. That was never the intent of revival. Revival is for the church to call back to life those who have forgotten or slidden or been taken advantage of by the enemy. The book of Revelation, and it's interesting to me because this is a letter that Jesus wrote to the church in Ephesus, which is the same church that Paul's writing to. He says, yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. That is a call to revival, not to the world. The world needs to be raised from the dead, but the church sometimes, you sometimes, I sometimes need a breath again. You ever had the wind knocked out of you? Oh man, is that a terrible feeling? It's like, I'm gonna die here. It's because the breath has left for an instant and it needs to be brought back. And that's the picture of revival. I've done CPR on hundreds of people, most of whom died. But there's a couple of people I remember in the course of my career that I was the pumper, so to speak, that came back. And I was astonished. That's revival. That's a picture of revival, where life is given back, where it's beginning to wane, it's beginning to drift, it's beginning to fall. God has given us righteousness to protect our hearts, but it has to match. We have to wear it. We have to put it on and carry it. Then verse 15 says, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. One of my favorite movies is Forrest Gump. Anybody like that movie? And there's a scene where Forrest and Bubba are getting off the helicopter in Vietnam. You remember that? And they first meet Lieutenant Diane. Lieutenant Diane. And they're walking up the beach, and he's walking toward a shower. And Lieutenant Dan says to them, he says, there's one item that a soldier needs more than anything else. Anybody know what it is? Dry socks. Cushion sole OD green. And then he says this, because the Mekong, meaning the Mekong Delta, will eat a grunge's feet right off his legs. If you're in an army that the only way you can move is on your feet, maybe cushion sole OD green socks is what you need. Well, here's what the Romans realized. Our soldiers need good shoes to wear. And so they fashioned for them individually. They had their own cobbler to make them individual shoes. And we got a picture of them. It looked like this. We can call them sandals, but they weren't actually sandals. There's a name for it, the caligae. My Latin. Oh. They were shaped from a single piece of leather, and then it was wrapped above the foot, and then it was wrapped behind the foot, and then it was bound together. And then they put three layers of sole on it. And then the last layer, they would put these hobnails in it. Think about that. It's early in the morning. You're going to face an army that you're just going to bash each other. And the grass is wet. And everybody's wearing leather-soled sandals, except for the Romans. They're wearing football cleats. And they hit. Who do you think's going down? It wasn't the Romans. Josephus, a Jewish first century historian who wrote a great deal, said this, that much of the success of Caesar's army had to do with the footwear he issued to his troops. They traveled further and faster than any other army, and they astounded their enemies. Their enemies were caught off guard because they traveled so fast in these thick, stud-covered boots that they wore to the battle. And Paul's painting a picture of us here. And he says, if you're going to be the army of God, if you're going to invade enemy territory, he says you're going to have to stand. And if you're going to have to stand, you better be wearing football cleats. You better be wearing something you can dig in with and something you can dig into. And what does he say it is? It is the preparation to bring the gospel. And the irony of it is it's not a gospel of war. It's a gospel of peace. To reiterate the fact that we're not at war with flesh and blood. We are not at war with people in the world. They are not our enemies. There but for the grace of God go you. And so our mission is to win them over, to take territory from the enemy. And God has equipped us, like the Roman soldiers, to be faster, to be smarter than the enemy is, and to walk in this preparation of the gospel of peace, which is our footwear. Cushion sole, OD green. Verse 16, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. The suttum, which was about 3 to 3.5 feet long, it was made out of wood. And I suppose they wet the wood because they shaped it and it had a slight curvature to it. And it was three layers glued together, laminated together. And then on the front was usually leather, sometimes linen if it was for a parade. But in battle, it was leather coated. And then there was brass usually put on that. And then there was a brass around the whole thing to tie it all together. Did we show that yet? There we go. Looks something like this. The soldier's shield. And Paul says it's to quench the flaming darts or the flaming arrows, the fiery darts of the enemy. By this time in history, people had learned that if you dip your arrows in pitch, or if you dip your spears in pitch, you can light them on fire and throw them at your enemy. And if they stick in their shields, it'll burn the shields up. So the Romans decided, well, when we go to war, we're going to coat these things with leather, and then we're going to wet them down. And this is what Paul's actually referring to, about extinguishing the fiery darts. That when the arrow hits, it's psh, and it goes out because it causes water to come out of the shield, basically, or from the leather. And the question that needs to arise in our minds is, what are these flaming arrows of the devil? What are these fiery darts that I face? See if you can identify with any of these. fear, discouragement, false guilt, wrong thinking, lies, doubt, envy, strife, gossip, accusations from without and from within, and condemnation. You see, this is what he hurls at, and much more. These are the things that he hurls at me. You ever been fearful of life? What was around the corner? You ever felt like that there's a little voice inside of you saying that you're not worthy? God doesn't love you? You can't live up to this. Move on. See, these are the ploys and the darts that the enemy throws. But the Bible says that our faith will defend us. For everyone born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Solomon said that God is a shield to them who take refuge in him. The shield is used to protect ourselves. Every soldier followed his shield in the battle. Never the other way around. They always led with their faith. And that's what the warriors of God do. Show us the next slide. This is called a phalanx. This is the church. When the Romans went into battle, they formed this formation. And they took the shields that were out front and they put them in front of them. And they took the shields of the guy next back of them and they made a roof. Show us the next slide. This is the Romans at battle. They were the first armored division. Actually, I think the Greeks invented this. But they took that from them. You see the church there? I need to have faith. I need for you to have faith. Because we're moving in an army. This is not Lone Ranger stuff. This is you, me, we're the army. So I need my faith in front of me, and I may need your faith to cover me in the battle. And this is a good picture. It's a wonderful picture of the church fighting in the battle that God has called us to. As we put these shields together, we become, well, a tank, basically. And then the last thing that I'm going to talk about this morning, and this, like I say, this is so brief and this is so cursory that it really demands more study, is in verse 17. I'm going to cut it off at half the verse because it says, take the helmet of salvation. I'm cutting it off there because next week we're going to talk about the offensive weapons that God has given us and how we need to take the battle. We are equipped to stand. We are equipped to press forward. We are equipped to protect ourselves. But next week we talk about how we take the battle to the enemy. The helmet of salvation. I brought my helmet. This is my third helmet, actually. The first one I had was yellow. It was ugly. And it was a more modern design. Everything was smooth. And we got rid of those because we decided we wanted to look more traditional. The second helmet that I had is in the fire prevention office in Galesburg on display because it's all burnt up. The closest I ever came to dying in a fire was when we were doing overhaul in a story and a half house, and John Cypern and I were upstairs by ourselves without a hose line. Not a smart thing to do. Thought the fire was out, but it wasn't. And it flashed over, which means you got about 15 seconds to live. And so we ran down a hallway and jumped out of the second story head first onto a garage, fortunately. And as I went through the window, I hit the sash above, and it knocked me back in the room, and I lost my hat. So my helmet burned up. This is my third one. I hate it. It's heavy. It's not balanced very well. If I were designing helmets for firefighters, I would make them look like motorcycle helmets, and I would encapsulate everything. But then you wouldn't look cool like a firefighter. But if I think these are heavy, and I'll tell you how heavy they are. We used to, when kids would come in, they'd want to wear our fire hats, and we would let them, they have little ear flips and stuff, until a little boy out east broke his neck trying on a fireman's hat one day. And so we decided that's not a smart thing to do. The Roman soldier's helmet was much heavier than that. It was made out of iron or brass, It has sort of a similar shape in the back that it has a lid on the back of it to keep things from going down your neck. From my reading this week and studying Roman armature, which I don't do every week, said that you could hit it with a sword and it usually wouldn't dent it. The only thing that could really, really destroy it was an old battle axe, which I'm not going any further than that with that one. Some of you got that. Paul says this, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Why is salvation the helmet? Because the battleground, that's really where it really plays out mostly, is in our minds. It's in our thoughts. The verse I read at the very first, these vain imaginations, these things that lift themselves up, are not people, they're thoughts, they're philosophies that rule and dominate people. And they come from the evil one. They come from the kingdom of darkness. And so God has given us protection. And the protection is our salvation. So we must be assured, and we must know that we have that helmet on. We must know that our salvation is secure in order that we may stand. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. We take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. Solomon says, as a man thinketh, so is he. Paul says, we must transform our minds and renew them. But here's the problem. Here's where the devil really attacks us. He tries to convince us that the salvation that God has done for us, the salvation that God has given us, is not working. It's not working in you. And it goes back to this idea of subjective righteousness. That yes, we are called to be holy as he is holy. But how many have been able to pull that off so far in your life? Good, I thought I was the only one that couldn't. Here's the good news. You are in process. I'm going to read a quote again from Martin Lloyd-Jones. And it comes from this study that he did on these gifts. And it's a comment he made about the helmet of salvation. It says this, putting on the helmet of salvation means that when you're attacked, besieged, tried, tempted, and the devil comes to you and says there's nothing in it, you might as well get out. Christianity makes false promises. It doesn't fulfill them. Give up. Chuck it. Leave. Lloyd-Jones says this, your answer is no. I have not been led astray by this teaching. I have always known, and perhaps we have not always known, but I want to tell you today, if you did not know this, I have always known that there are steps and stages of salvation. I know that I am saved from sin's penalty. I know that I am being saved from sin's power, and I know that I shall be completely saved from sin's presence. Do not be surprised that you're still capable of sin, even though God calls you to righteousness. But know this, the penalty for that sin went to the cross. It's a done deal if you believe in Christ. That is objective righteousness. Okay? But know this also. Those whom he foreknew, he did also predestine to be conformed to the image of Christ. That being conformed is a process. You haven't arrived yet. That's okay. It doesn't mean stop. It means keep going. But God's not so much interested, I believe, in where you are than he is interested in what direction you're going in. I've heard it said, I'd rather be an inch out of hell heading away from it than a million miles away heading in that direction. So I mean, that's why he calls us to repentance. He's not saying, I don't love you. He's saying, you're going the wrong way. Turn around. Come back. We are all being processed in our salvation. Don't become discouraged because you have not arrived yet. But strive to arrive. Right? The destination is what we're after in the journey. To be Christ and to be Christ-like is the destination that we're going toward. I know in whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. It does not surprise me, in ending, it does not surprise me that with the rise in liberal Christian circles and Christian thinking and in the philosophies of any way is the right way or that all paths lead to God, it does not surprise me that in an humanized New Age approach to faith that we no longer talk about spiritual warfare. It doesn't surprise me that it's an antiquated and obsolete thought, and that many people think it's archaic at best. And as battle songs are being removed from the hymnals, and the ideas of warfare and of battles and of standing and of holding your ground and of staying strong and being true are leaving the Christian vernacular, I'm not surprised, but I'm troubled that that is happening, because someone is setting us up, and it's the enemy. You see, all these ideas are tied with the idea of absolute truth. In an age where the only thing the world is dogmatic about is that you're not allowed to be dogmatic, the only thing they won't tolerate is intolerance, the only thing they know is there's absolutely no absolutes, and I just described a big dog chasing its own tail. There's a need to fight for the things that are absolute. There's a need to stand for these things. Truth, righteousness, the gospel, faith, salvation seem like they're worth fighting for. It's interesting that in a day when all of these things are under attack, truth, the gospel, faith, salvation, that our text says that these are our very protection, and that if we lose them, we're unprotected. What a paradox. How ironic. In the final analysis, we're not defending them. They are defending us. That gives me a great deal of hope and a great deal of joy to know that God is trusting me with his truth. It's his truth, not mine. That he's placing me inside his righteousness. It's not mine. That he gives me his gospel to proclaim, not mine. The salvation belongs to the Lord. It's not mine, but he's trusting us to have it and to walk in it, to model it, protect it, and to fight in it. The battle rages for us today. It's time that we take up the sword and take the battle back to the enemy. That's what we're going to talk about next week. Put on the whole armor of God so that you can stand. Does that make sense? Do you agree with that? Pray with me. Father God, we're so grateful that you have done all of these things for us, that you have built, that you have bought, that you have purchased for us this great armor, and that you care about those who are in your army. Help us, Lord, to stand as warriors in the warfare that we've been called to, in the warfare that's been thrust upon us even when we don't want it. And help us to be strong and mighty in the Lord. We thank you for that in Jesus' name.